Okay. So before I start with my presentation, I wanted to know how many over here know MQTT protocols or know anything about MQTT. Yeah, I know you. Anyone else? Okay. Other people? Fine. Before I start with... So today's topic is I'll be discussing about attack scenarios and security analysis of MQTT protocol. And before I discuss different scenarios, I'll start with the basics of MQTT. The full form of MQTT is message queuing telemetry transport. And MQTT protocol is used by the IoT device to communicate with each other. So this is the basic diagram MQTT network is having. The main feature of MQTT protocol is it's really lightweight. So we can use it on a situation like remote areas where network is limited, bandwidth is limited. We can use it with IoT devices having a limited access, like having limited memory or power source. We can use this protocol on that devices. Also, we can use it in a situation where we required precise monitoring of data without delay or without less delay. So those are the scenarios where MQTT is really useful. So yeah, MQTT is machine-to-machine Internet of Thing connectivity protocol, and it is designed as extremely lightweight. The service it uses published subscribe service messaging transport, and it is useful for connection with remote location where small code footprint is required and our network bandwidth is limited. So this is something about MQTT protocol. Okay, so let's start with the history. First time it was introduced in 1999 in IBM by these two guys. Name as Andy Stanford and Alan Neeper, sorry. And they have used this protocol for the first time to monitor fuel lines in a desert area. So that was the first time MQTT protocol has been introduced and used. The other history about MQTT version is something. The first time it got a royalty-free release in 2010. So just see the difference, the time difference. It just introduced in 1999 and the first release has been made in 2010, which is really vast. But after that, it's really, demanding. MQTT protocol is get demands, and it's become a favorite protocol to for the communication. And furthermore, in 2013, the first HiveMQ initial public release has been made in 2014. It got OSS standardized. In 16, ISO standard has been got by the MQTT protocol. The new MQTT protocol version has been introduced in 2018. In 2018, on the same year, HiveMQ 4 has been got released, and in 2019 there were three releases for the MQ, the HiveMQ client public release has been made. With that, HiveMQ got open source, and MQTT 5 is also got OSS standard. In this history version, you have also seen one more terminology, that is HiveMQ. So what is that? So now, when two devices are communicating with each other, it's having using MQTT protocol. So maybe some of the devices are using the older version of MQTT protocol, that is MQTT 3, and the new device must be on a new version of MQTT, that would be maybe the 5. So both the devices would not be able to communicate with each other. So to provide a bridge, HiveMQ is there. With the help of HiveMQ, different version of MQTT would be able to communicate with each other. So that is what HiveMQ is all about. Some of the key features of MQTT is you'll be able to communicate, you will establish a communication from one to many via broker. The other one is we can have acknowledgement of request. So actually MQTT is having a facility that is called QoS, quality of service, QoS 0, 1 and 2. 0 means you won't be able to get acknowledgement. I know these terms, what I'm describing right now, maybe you guys who don't know the MQTT won't be able to understand that much accurately, but try to go home and learn something about MQTT so this everything will make sense. Because I am taking a session on attack scenarios, so I have to, you know, describe those things. So that is why I am displaying the key features of MQTT. So yeah, so I was talking about QoS functionality. So QoS 0 is something we won't get any acknowledgement. QoS 1 will any one acknowledgement client will get, and the QoS 2 is something each and every request would get acknowledged. So now, as you know, each and every request would get acknowledgement. That means it will be overhead for MQTT as well. So it's a feature and yeah, it's overhead as well. So you have to decide how you want to use it. Sorry. The packet format is really simpler one because it's a binary one, and the other key feature is it's run over a TCP. So yeah, that is also a one key feature of MQTT. Some of the major areas where MQTT protocol is getting used are, of course, the first one is IoT device. The other one is IIoT. This thing is known as IoT, industrial IoT. So let's say there is a company who is manufacturing a car. So rather to assign a people who will assemble your car, you can design a machine who can, you know, assemble a car for you. So the productivity will get increased and the investment would be reduced, and you know, you get higher productivity, and of course if machine is working for you. So you can code a machine, you can online give command to machine that where to fit chair and where to fit glass or where to fit the gate of the cars. So those everything we can do using MQTT protocol. The other thing, the other major areas are fitness and health device. So let's say person wants to know how much area did he covered while running on a particular time period. So you know, those are the observations we require to have appropriate data on a particular time frame. So as it's a lightweight, it we application won't get that much of delay, and yeah, we got a precise data. So that is the also one area where MQTT is getting used. And in health device, yeah, we can observe a blood pressure and everything with that. Okay, we can also track any person using MQTT. And yeah, so automation, home automation kit. This is also the major area for MQTT. You can switch on, off lights, ACs, geysers, anything from within the house and from outside the house. It's just, you know, you have the whole control of your home on your device on one single tab. You'll do everything. So that is that everything you can do using MQTT protocol. That is where MQTT protocol is being used nowadays. And some of the cloud servers are also using MQTT protocol. And Microsoft, AWS, Amazon, IBM, and Google are the major and most rated client who is using MQTT. So this is all I'm covering about MQTT. Let's start how MQTT protocol works. I mean, how we can do communication and how IoT device can communicate using MQTT. Okay. So MQTT is having two entities. One is known as broker, MQTT broker, and the other are known as clients. Clients can be broadly divided into two parts, publisher and subscriber. Publisher will publish their data, and a subscriber accordingly will consume those data. So before subscriber will consume the data, they have to subscribe to the particular topic. So broker will come to know what data he has to provide to what subscriber, which subscriber he has to provide which data. Okay, so because of that, first subscriber will subscribe to brokers. Like the first one want to know the room temperature, and the another subscriber want to know the roof temperature. So when publisher will publish, that room temperature will be 20 Celsius. That will only deliver to the subscriber who has subscribed for that specific topic. So this is the basic idea how MQTT protocol works. Same if room temperature is 50 Celsius, the particular subscriber will get those data who has subscribed for this topic. Okay, so this is the diagram of MQTT network. So I just want to you guys to know that brokers can communicate with each other, multiple client can subscribe for multiple topics, as well as they can publish multiple topic. And also a client who is subscribing for one topic can also publish the other one. So there is no bind. So MQTT network is really dynamic when you have to decide how you want to use it. Okay. Fine. So yeah, I had made a topic hierarchy. Let's say I want to know my house temperature, which is having first floor, second floor and roof. In first floor there is a drawing room and room. In second floor there is a room and kitchen. So now I want to know the temperature of room temperature which is on first floor. So I have to subscribe something like temp/floor1/room. But now I want to know the room temperature, any room temperature of any floor. So this I can do like temp/plus/room. And if I want to subscribe for any topic I want to know the temperature of every rooms and kitchens and roof available in my home, I have to subscribe something like temp/hash. Hash is also known as wildcard entry, because with the help of hash we can subscribe all the topics present on the particular broker. I am explaining this to you guys all because we are using these topics. So you guys need to have a basic understanding of these things. Some of the basics command we are going to use throughout this demo process are if we want to start the broker server, as I am using a Mosquito as to create the whole MQTT network. In my case, it would be Mosquito. We can also combine. So there are some options we can configure Mosquito with, but we will come to know later in the demo part. If you want to subscribe for any topic, this would be the command, as I'm using Mosquito again. Mosquito _sub-t and topic name. Whatever the topic you want to subscribe for, you have to mention that name over here. If we want to publish a data, so the command would be Mosquito, in my case, Mosquito_sub-t, topic name -m and message. So there are many providers who's providing service for the MQTT. That is MQTT Paho is there also, but I am using Mosquito, so my all the demos will cover command, and I'll taking the Mosquito as my basic network creation platform. Okay, so as I say before, MQTT use TCP for the basic communication. So whatever the communication we are doing, it would be all in clear text, which is, I don't think so, the good one. Of course, anyone can sniff your traffic. We can start Wireshark and, ta-da, we can get all your data. So it's not good, right? Okay, we are getting over here username, password as well. So we can configure our servers. like without valid credential, no client would be able to subscribe or publish those data, something like that. But now, let's suppose all the communication is in clear text. So, but I had configured my server to make it secure. But what if communication is in clear text? I'm getting those data easily. I'm getting the credentials over here. So now I do have a credential. I can subscribe to that particular server. So that is the first scenario I'm discussing about. As a prevention mechanism, MQTT has implemented TLS. We can run MQTT on HTTPS, right? But as I mentioned earlier as well, MQTT is used by the devices having limited resources, like having a limited memory resource or having a limited power source. So, does those devices would be able to, inherit this encrypted traffic on that? If those are such a tiny devices and those devices are not having that much of space, so sometimes what happen, though we do have a technology that we can secure our network, but we are unable to do that all because our devices are not compatible. So that is one issue we have to take care when we are communicating or deploying the MQTT network. Okay, we can also use MQTT over internet. Just a second. I had made a different demos to discuss the scenarios. So for the first demo, I had used Shodan. Everyone knows Shodan, right? At least Shodan, everyone knows, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, thank you so much. Okay, so it's a search engine and used for the IoT. If you want to get any information about IoT devices, what protocol it's using, and what are the online IoT device right now over the network, we can use Shodan for that. So I'm just searching for MQTT protocol. Before we start with the right part of the displayed page, we will first focus on the left part. First thing, is it visible to you guys? It's a video, I don't know how to zoom it. Guys, if you want to have a look, I'm so sorry, but you have to just come ahead. There is a vacant seat over here as well. And anyways, I'm describe those things so that may help, and I'll share those details with you so you can have a look afterwards as well. So in left part, they have given the list of most favorite products that IoT devices are using. As you can see over here, MQTT and Mosquito are the most top rated products used by the IoT devices, and the number is in 5 digits. Okay, and the third product which is used by the IoT device was MongoDB, but the number is in 2 digits, that is 30. And when it comes for the MQTT and Mosquito, the number is something like 50,000, around 50,000. So you just can understand how many IoT devices are using MQTT protocol. Other thing, if you can see over here, I'm so sorry if it's not visible, but top service is 1883. 1883 is default port where MQTT communication will be made. And again, the number IoT devices use this port, default port, is around 80,000. Whereas the second top rated port has a number something like 60. So you just see the difference, how popular MQTT is and how many devices are MQTT to communicate with each other by the IoT devices. So that is the main reason I want to show the left part of this site. Let's come to the right one. Those are the IPs which are publicly, which are on the internet. So you can directly access those IPs, and whatever those IPs are delivering, those data we can access as well. Now over here, as you can see, MQTT connection code is 0. That is what display over here. 0 means there is no authentication mechanism is provided or implemented on that particular broker. What that means is also, as there is no authentication mechanism, there is nothing to validate any particular subscriber or publisher. Anyone can, you know, access those data. And the number of topics are also given over here. So what we will try to do now is we will subscribe any one of the I'll pick any IP address and I'll try to subscribe for that. So you know I can get data of that particular IP address. I mean, what are the topics that broker is having and what are the messages is this particular broker is sharing with his or its clients basically. Also, I have used over here -v. -v is for verbose mode, which will display the topic name as well as the message delivered to the clients. So this is a Huawei cloud service. Okay, the topic is energy. So it's sharing the data of energy level of device. Device is highlighted over here. That is device_SN. That may be the mobile device or any other device which is using this service. So over here we are able to see the energy level of that particular device, which is in max, energy level are in term, it's displaying maximum, minimum and average energy level of that particular topic. Okay. If you guys are not able to see, please come ahead because the seats are vacant, so you guys will be able to see. Okay. I'd also take one other IP from the internet and subscribe for the same. But unfortunately, those data are not in readable format. Now, the other thing what I can do is I can subscribe. I can publish my data on their broker as well, but I'm not going to do that as I'm sharing demos over that. But anyways, I had made the same broker server in my local host, and the same way I'll be publishing data over there, we'll be able to publish data on the internet published brokers. So okay, it's my phone window. I had deployed a local broker and it's a client. So I had implement two switches over here, LED and meter. LED would have two stages on and off. Meter would be in having a three stage, low, medium and high. Okay, so now if I want to, I want LED to be on stage, I have to publish something like -t topic. In my case, I have put it LED and the message appropriately, so LED should work. So over here, okay. So as you guys can see, -t LED is a topic and M is on. So yeah, as you can see, LED blinked up. Okay. Let's try with the meter as well. But now let's consider the another scenarios. There is one factory, which is having a system something like if some critical situation or some disastrous situation will happen, they will have a LED or siren which will, you know, sounds on, and which that mean is employers have to vacate the factory as early as possible. Okay, and their whole system is on publicly, I mean on internet, and now I got access over that particular network, and that particular network. So what I can do is just imagine I'm just publishing the data which will light up that LED or siren. So that's it. I mean, nothing else you guys have to do. There would be chaos in that particular factory, I guess. The other demo I'm showing over here is for the meter. As I earlier say, it's having a three-stage, low, medium, and high. Let's see if we are also able to work with the meter. Seven. Okay. So here, how we can subscribe to the particular MQTT server. And this is actually the GUI one. Just a second. This is provide the GUI, whatever the command we are firing. And at the bottom side, as you can see, those are the terminal, I mean message, what publisher has published, we will be able to get over there. So it's just for the demo purpose, I have put both the things over here. Okay. My other situation would be we can also publish MQTT over, we can also integrate MQTT with the applications. Okay, MQTT has a facility that we can transfer MQTT data over a web sockets. So let's see, we are integrating the MQTT with the, I had made one of my application in which what it does, it just do is it will just show whatever the message we have published. This application I had just made for the demo purpose, and I had hard coded IP address as well as the topic. It's just for the demo purpose, but yeah, we can integrate it very efficiently. And let's start first. So as I said before, we have to use WebSocket if we want to integrate MQTT over a browser, over application, if we want to use MQTT protocol. So for that, we have to make some configuration changes in configuration file, which will understand that my data would be traveling over the WebSocket. So that would be done on a config file of the MQTT. This should be your configuration settings while you want to convey your data over a WebSockets. And I'm just restarting the server. Okay. Guys, I do have a limited time, so I'm just, you know, fast-tracking my speech, okay? So pardon for that. Okay. So I had restarted my server and it's just got connected over the WebSocket. And over here, as you can see, my page is connected by the MQTT protocol. Now I want to publish my data. Now the thing is, Mosquito server is not providing inbuilt facility that I will be able to communicate over the socket. So I had used MQTT PAHO with JavaScript to make this work. So this command are from MQTT PAHO. Now hyphen H would be the host name. Hyphen H is the host name. P is the port. As WebSocket, I had marked the port is 9001. Hyphen C is service name, on what service you want to, you know, travel your data. That is WS in my case. Hyphen T is topic, that is browser. This is again I had made hard coded, okay? And let's see what the message. Okay, so message I want to display on the browser is message from terminal. Let's see. Yeah, here we got the result. So now I can see that I'm able to communicate with the terminal. Now, what if, you know, I'm appending a simple XSS payload. So let's see, if proper sanitization has not been done by the web application, what happens over here? Whoops, XSS got executed. So that was the basic demo, but just imagine if we have integrated MQTT with our application, and now the data which we are passing through the MQTT is getting stored in the SQL database. We can also do SQL injections, some other injection we can also perform, like OS and command as well. So yeah, if you are integrating the MQTT over the web application, you have to think about such a situation, and you have to sanitize those vulnerability. Okay. The other demo I'm going to give is subscribing to the topic by changing the creating a new credential. Now let's assume my MQTT network is on HTTPS. Okay, so that would be on a clear text. Again, I had put some mechanism that without valid credentials, I won't be able to subscribe or publish my data. But so now how we will be able to get how we will be able to get data published for the broker and subscribe our data to the broker? So in that case, let's assume that attacker somehow got hold on the MQTT server. Okay. Okay. So what else we can do with that? So here I had first of all seen the basic scenarios I'm just skipping this. We are assuming, I have to show that. Okay, so this is the valid subscriber and that is the valid publisher. Both are publishing and subscribing with a valid credential. Now, this is attacker. VM machine is attacker one. I'm trying to subscribe from the attacker machine. But of course, I don't know the credential. Then, let's see. I'll be able to, able to subscribe for those topics. So of course I'm getting error, something like connection is refused. So now I'm not able to communicate with the broker if I don't have a valid credentials, but somehow attacker got hold on the server. So what else he can do? Every configuration made for the server is every server is having a config file through which it will get its other configuration, custom configuration. So in my case, it's a config.conf file. So over here, as written, allow anonymous equals to false. Because of that, this line, we are unable to access broker without authentication, without valid credential. And again, over the first line says password file and the path of the password file. So the credentials are stored in that particular file. So you must, everyone must be thinking about I'm getting access to config file, then why I directly won't be going to change that file? Some cases we'll be able to change this file. So directly we can, delete those data and we can directly access the server, but not each and every time. We can have a read permission, but we cannot write and execute those things. So in some of the scenarios, we won't be able to change the configuration of config files specifically. But something else we can do with. That is where we can, you know, add, append the passwords in the password files. MQTT provide this that facility using hyphen B. We can append a password using hyphen B into the existing password file. So in my case, password is attacker. Username is attacker, and password I had kept the same. That is attacker only. The other way we can do is we can directly change that file. Okay, we can, you know, remove the data stored in that particular file, and we can update that file with our data. We can do that using. So I'm so sorry, I forgot to show you one more thing. The other scenario what we can think about is why we are not directly accessing that password file and, you know, get credentials access. But as you can see over here, password is in encrypted form. Though we will be able to decrypt that, but why to waste that much of time where we will be able to, add our credentials to that configuration file. Sorry, to that password file. And we can get access to the broker server. So that is what I'm doing over here with hyphen B. And hyphen C would directly update the file. So but I don't want to update the existing one. So I had made the another one. And putting this file in configuration one. And now let's see if I'll be, you know, able to get, I mean, my attacker, my VMware machine is able to get details or message from the broker server. So here in first case, I'm, subscribing for top. Attacker is subscribing to every topic under a topic. So that would be topic / plus. So now he'll be able, must be able to get data from both the topic, that is topic / 1 and topic / 2 in this demo. Okay. So let's see. Firstly, publisher is publishing data for topic 2. Of course, valid subscriber is getting data, but with that, broker is also getting data. So our task has been done. I mean, no need to do anything else. So yeah, so that is the purpose of this demo. Of also, as subscriber, attacker has subscribed for every topic. If a publisher is published for the topic / one topic, attacker would able to get details of that message as well. So that is how you can play with the configuration file as well if you get hold on the broker server. Okay. I had made one small demo on the backdoor. I have created one small backdoor through which you can create a file, get information about the file, and you can delete that file. We can also perform ls operation using that backdoor. I'm just showing it as a demo. I'll not make just a second. And first of all, I'm really sorry because I had taken the video in the half portion of the screen. I'm so sorry, I just got broke with my screen, so that way. So we here, let's assume client is having one malicious file, okay? So let's assume that our malicious file is already in execution mode. Our Python server is already running. Subscriber is subscribing for those particular topics. Okay. Now, publisher is publish the details or data for that particular topic. So, dev / 1. I configured it to provide data of ls-l command. So let's check whether I'll be able to get that or no. Not. So my topic in this case is dev-1. Okay. And message was hi. So over here, as you guys can see, I got information about ls command, as you can guys can see. The other one is, what I'm doing is I'm okay, just hold on a second. Okay, so now I'm creating a file on client's computer. Again, backdoor I have made hard coded. So the file would be created at temp folder. Name would be file slash dot one, and command is -t would be sys slash file, and message is create, which indicate that it has to made a file. So yeah, file has been created over there. To check the permission of the file, we have to type command info. Over here, as you can see, file information has been displayed. And to remove that file, the command is command is -m should be false. Fine. So let's see. I'm moving to the temp folder. Yeah, I'm not able to get that file. So that means my backdoor is working properly. Let's again check with the info publish. So as there is no file, you won't be able to get information. So it's saying return non-zero exist status. Okay. So I had made it just for the demo purpose. And yeah, I'm concluding my session over here. Thank you so much for listening me patiently. Thank you guys.